Greetings. Today we're going to talk about engineering standards as a part of the design process. We're going to talk about why we use standards. We're going to talk about where we find standards. We're going to talk about why they're an important part of the process. And we're going to try to give you some insight into why standards are very important. First of all, they are a legal necessity. If you design things and do not consider the ramifications and the considerations of codes and standards, you can rest pretty well assured that you're going to end up in court, because you need to know what the consensus of the design community believes is an important part of this product. And that will be reflected by what is usually called generally accepted good engineering practice, and that is reflected again in codes and standards. Again, or in addition, many common objects have already been designed, so why do them over again? So use a standard and you will get that prior knowledge brought into it. They greatly simplify your drawings and your callouts. As you may know, your principal communication tool as a designer is your drawings. And if you want to control those drawings carefully so that purchasing has the right information, so that receiving inspection has the right information, so that post-inspection has the right information, so that tooling knows where to start their processes, then you need to be very accurate and very detailed on those drawings. Standards help you do that greatly. Always remember, drawings really aren't for engineering. Drawings are for the people who are going to make this thing, buy the parts, and make sure they're the right quality. The slide you see in front of you now shows two different views of a bolt. On the left, you'll see the thread that you would have to draw if you didn't call out a standard, and you'll see it's very detailed. On the right, you'll see a very small call out on the right-hand side that says #4-40UNF-2A(B1.1). That contains all the same information as that drawing on the left. Which would you rather do when you're making a drawing? Well, it seems to me that you would rather just make the simplified call out, and you're controlling what you get at that point. And everybody else knows what you're calling out when you do that. If you're interested in knowing what that call out means, there's a little table there underneath on the right-hand side. What is a standard? A standard is a written description of the criteria for a specific product, process, test, or procedure that is agreed to by a formal process. In the United States, the formal process is controlled by an organization called the American National Standards Institute, or ANSI. They are the people that come up with the process. They actually write no standards. People call out standards all the time and say, I want ANSI B1.1. But ANSI did not write that standard. Actually, ASME wrote that standard, or the American Society of Mechanical Engineers. So this ANSI controls the process. Other people develop the standard. There are several types of standards. There are consensus standards. That's what I've been talking about. That's where a group of people, usually from a common industry group, get together and put together and agree on various things that make a standard. The interesting thing about that is, of course, to get agreement amongst a large body of people, one is usually then working with kind of the lowest common denominator of the standard. So standards in many ways represent minimum acceptable design practices. They don't always and they don't often represent the actual state of the art. They represent, again, minimums. There are other kinds of standards. They're de facto standards. Most of you know about Adobe Acrobat. That's not a standard in the sense of the world has decided that's a standard, but that's become a standard because we all use it. And then there are many government codes and standards. The EPA has them, OSHA has them, state agencies have them to control things like heating and air conditioning in buildings and those sorts of things. So the Consumer Protection Agency has them. So those have a little more teeth in them because they have the effect of law. Who generates standards? As I said before, it's usually a professional body, IEEE, ASTM, SAE. If you don't know these acronyms, there won't be a quiz on them at the end. But nevertheless, these are various professional bodies that put together standards that are done via a formal process to come up with a standard that's then promulgated around the world. ASME spends over $20 million a year on its standards making process, which is a really interesting number because they pay no one who are on these committees anything. So this is just their internal costs for doing this. standards, you can see on the slide in front of you a screenshot from an ASME webpage, and below that to the right, you can see a screenshot from our particular viewer that lets us look at things that are in our library. We call it MADCAT, our catalog here in Madison. And you can see the same standard in the MADCAT reference. Codes and standards are very hard to find. Why? Well, they're expensive. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. As I said before, ANSI doesn't write standards. ANSI promulgates standards. ANSI serves as our representative on the International Standards Organization and other things. But they bring people together who write standards. There are over 1,300 members in the ANSI circle of friends, or the ANSI people who develops code, who are members of ANSI. There are 200 accredited developers, American Society of Mechanical Engineers, Society of Automotive Engineers, and many other people, including the AICHE. The U.S. process for standards development says, first of all, you have to be an accredited developer. Just anybody can't do this. And then there's a process by which you submit a draft, you get the right people together, the draft is reviewed, and then finally it's put on the street. The standard is reviewed every 5 years to see if it needs updating, changing, improving, or if it can just be used as is. As I said before, ANSI is our sole representative to the International Standards Organization, and this is becoming an ever more important body. As commerce becomes ever more worldwide, people want one set of standards to go to. They don't want to have to go to the U.S. standards and the British standards and the European standards and the Japanese standards. They want to go to one set of standards. So the international standards are becoming much more important. The slide in front of you shows there are now 157 countries that contribute to the International Standards Organization. We are one of them. And on the right-hand side near the bottom, you'll see the DIN organization. That's Germany. Germany is a very good promoter of standards. You find them often when you're dealing with metric fasteners. As a general rule, companies that do worldwide business, and you now see the chairman of the Caterpillar on the slide, companies that do a worldwide business want international standards because they don't want to have different equipment to go into different markets. It helps. Also, it helps level the competition worldwide. It helps minimize costs for development and testing. And it gives a baseline for new developing, adapting technologies so everybody's on a similar playing field. There are two primary international standards organizations today. There's the ISO that I already talked about, which has over 16,000 standards, and ANSI participates in that in about 80% of their technical committees. There's the IEC, the International Electrotechnical Commission, and ANSI also participates in that. They're primarily into electronics, magnetics, telecommunications, and that sort of thing. They have almost 5,000 standards that they're working on. A very quick example, so that you can see how to use a standard. This might not be an example that's important to you. However, there's probably no one watching this who's not used a bolt and a nut. That's why I picked this as a standard, so to show you what this does. So the bolt standard covers all the dimensions and tolerances that you see on the screen in front of you. If without the standard, you have to draw all these dimensions, all these tolerances. What's the surface condition? What's the hardness of the material? How straight do you want it to be? What's the thread form? All those sorts of things. And even more. So on the next slide, you see even more that you have to deal with there. The standard covers even the very small dimensions, the fillets as they go through the head, all those things. I mean, we aren't going to go through and draw one of these or understand how to do that. But it's very important to understand that without the standard, you would have to do all of this to get the kind of fastener that you want. Nuts are similar. There's a nut standard that does all the same thing. Actually, the thread standard is the same for both bolts and nuts. One's an internal thread, one's an external thread, obviously. But again, all this information we need in order to draw one of these, but we don't have to have it because we have standards. The threads already showed you a quick example. This is a blow-up. You can see they're very intricate to do bolts, nuts, and threads. And the call-outs are very important. The mating between the nut and the bolt, or between the internal thread and the external thread, is extremely important, and we actually call out the mate when we make a proper standards call out. You can see up here class 1, 2, 3 for A and B. A is external threads, B is internal threads, and you can see that as we go from 1 to 3, we get a tighter fit, so the threads mate better. Better mating may or may not be good, because the better it mates, the more difficult it is to assemble the fastener, and the more problem you have with dirt, grit, and those sorts of things. So there's a trade-off there between manufacturability and assembly that has to go on. And you as an engineer have to decide what is that trade-off and what's best for what you're doing. Standards are very difficult to find. Why? Because they're expensive. So that means that the people who own the copyright for these particular standards want to charge you significant dollars to have them. You will find it very difficult to find them full text online. You will find places that you can find abstracts online. Then you will usually end up dealing with, yes, really, paper. Think about that. I know most of you are young enough that paper is not a very important thing for you anymore. You think all information comes on Google. But you will actually find most of these standards that you will need will still be in paper form or maybe on a CD in somebody's library. It takes a lot of work to find, first of all, what standards do you need? That's a significant effort. But it's a bigger effort to actually put those in your hands because they're expensive, again, and hard to find. So where do you find them? Well, if you're lucky and you can use military standards and it's a reasonably old one, you can find it through this Assist Military database that's on the screen in front of you. Unfortunately, that's going away because that database has been basically sold or given or something to the Society of Automotive Engineers, who's now bringing that out in a slightly newer form and charging us for it. Then the NSSN is a database that ANSI puts together. And that is a good place to search. These are both public databases. You need no special keys, words, or anything to get into them, though you may need to register to get into the Assist Military database. They like to know who's looking at their things. But nevertheless, you can get into these. But the NSSN database is not full text. You will be lucky to find the standards you want in full text. You'll be doing pretty good to find an abstract that makes sense to you, then go try to find the full text. So it means if you're doing codes and standards work, you need to make a friend of your local library and particularly your reference librarian. I can tell you that about half the time that I personally go look for a standard, I don't find it. And then I ask a reference librarian and they find it for me. So the problem with this is how they are usually put in different kinds of systems in different libraries. So it's hard to, you know, they may be filed under the ANSI designation or they may be filed under the ASME designation and yet they're the same standard. Okay. So learn who your library and librarian are. If there's a large research library in your area, they're more likely to have this than a smaller library. In the Madison area, in my area, that large library, in addition to, of course, our Wendt library on campus, which is our engineering library, but that large library is the Milwaukee library. It's very interesting. They have a very good collection of standards, and I often get standards from the Milwaukee library. Another place to find standards, again, not full text, but to find what standards you might need is specific organizations' websites. Go to the SAE website. Go to the AWS, that's the American Welding Society. Go to their website and they will list their standards. Of course, they're listing them primarily so they can sell them to you. But that's okay. You can use their search engine and you can find the standard that you may want. Then you can go search for it in the library or wherever it may be. But these, again, it won't be easily done. So, in conclusion, standards will save you design and testing time. They will eliminate tedious drawing call-outs and redesign of things that the world has already designed. They'll also help, they won't completely isolate you from, they'll help keep you safe from some litigation. It's very important to understand that we have a litigious society and we need to design things within standards and so that people know that we are doing what other people have done. The worldwide unification is helping in some ways. But the ISO charges for their standards too, so it's difficult to find these standards and get to use them. I can offer you this advice in terms of finding standards. It will be harder than you want it to be. It will take you longer than you want it to take. And once you find the information, it will be very useful to you. So it's worth the effort, but it's difficult to do. Don't forget, there are lots of other sources for codes and standards. This is an overview. NASA has a whole website of codes and standards. Again, you have to register and go through a few hoop jumping so they don't think that you're trying to steal all their information, etc. But there's plenty of other sources for codes and standard information. But the key is to work hard to find it. Got a question? You'll find me on the UW website. So look me up and drop me an email if you'd like. I hope you have a great day.